What's up, game developers? CouchFerret here, and today we'll create a crosshair and shoot arrows. We'll also make the aiming and shooting animations by extending our blend trees. And in the end, we'll script a position locking mechanism and define keyboard and mouse inputs. If it sounds fun, then stay with me and consider subscribing with the bell icon so you won't miss any future videos of this game. You can also follow me on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. Cool, let's begin! Let's start with creating a crosshair game object for aiming. We have a crosshair sprite already, so let's drag and drop it into the archer. We move this game object based on the controller inputs. Because the crosshair is a child object of the archer game object, it will move together with the archer. Let's jump back into the code. First, we need to declare a public variable for it. After that, let's create a new function called aim. In this function, we need to change the crosshair's local position instead of its position to move it relative to the archer. Let's set it to the movement direction. But to keep the crosshair from jumping back into the middle of the archer, we should only set its local position when the movement direction is not a zero vector. So let's wrap it into a similar if statement that we have in the animate function. Now, we only need to call this function in the update function and save the script. Before we hit play, we need to drag and drop the crosshair game object into the scripts field. Okay, it works, but the crosshair is a bit too far from the archer, so let's change that. If we declare a crosshair distance variable, then we can fine-tune the crosshair's distance from the archer later in the inspector window. But to actually change the distance, we need to multiply the line that moves the crosshair with the crosshair distance variable. Let's check it out. Now we can easily change its value and find one that we like the most. Let's go with 0.4. Okay, let's implement the arrow shooting. We'll define a new function for it and name it shoot. Also, we have to call it in the update function. In this shoot function, we'll implement the arrow shooting based on the crosshair's position. So let's define a shooting direction vector 2 with the value of crosshair.transform.localPosition. We need to normalize this new shooting direction vector so it won't change the arrow speed. We only want to shoot arrows when we release the shooting button on the controller. We use an if statement for this, but first we need the new input to check if we release the button or not. Let's scroll up and declare a new variable under the character statistics group and name it end of aiming. In the process inputs function, let's assign player.getButtonUpFire1 to it. This will only have the true value in the exact frame when we release the button. If you aren't using rewired, then you have to change the player to input. By default, Unity defines this Fire1 input and maps it to the left mouse button and joystick button 0, but in Rewired, I have to do it myself. Cool! Now we can use it in the if statement. First, we have to create a new arrow based on the arrow prefab we have from previous episodes. To use it here, we need to have a reference for the prefab, so let's scroll up and declare a variable for it. I think it would be better if we put the prefab under a new prefabs header instead of mixing it with the references. We need to jump back into Unity and drag and drop the prefab into the variables field. This prefab is just a sprite with a rigid body 2D component on it. Now we can create a new arrow with the instantiate function. Its first parameter is the arrow prefab because we want a copy of that. The second parameter is the position of the new game object. We can use the archer's position for this. And the third parameter is its rotation, so type quaternion.identity there to keep the original rotation, because I'll be rotating it later. We have to save this new game object into a variable, so we can change its velocity and rotation later. Let's start with the arrow's velocity. We can access the arrow's velocity through its rigid body 2D component. Let's set it to the shooting direction vector, and to think a bit ahead, let's multiply it with a new variable called arrow base speed. We need to scroll up and declare this new variable, so we can set it later. Now let's rotate the arrow based on the shooting direction vector. We need to convert this vector to an angle with the mathf.8on2 function. Be careful with the order of the coordinates, the y comes first and then the x. And finally, we have to multiply it by the mathf.rad2dig to convert it from radian to degree. I explained this whole conversion and the math behind it in a previous episode. Check it out if you haven't watched it yet. Finally, we need to destroy the fired arrows after a while, so they won't clutter our scene. The destroy function has a handy timer parameter, so we can destroy the arrows after 2 seconds. Let's try it out. The arrows are a bit slow, so let's crank up their speed to 3. That's better. Also, the arrows come out of the archer's legs. The problem is that the archer game object's pivot point is at the bottom of the sprites. We need to move the sprite's game object down a bit to have the pivot at the center. If the moving gizmo isn't in the right place, make sure to toggle the tool handle position to pivot instead of center. Now we have to fix the circle collider's offset to compensate for this change. Awesome! It works perfectly. The arrows come from the center and the sprite sorting hasn't changed. Now let's make the animations. First, we'll need a new variable called isAiming. This will represent whether the archer is currently aiming or not. Let's declare it under the endofAiming variable and assign a value to it in the processInputs function. Instead of getButtonUp, this will be just getButton, which gives back a true value if the button is pressed and a false when it isn't. Once we are here and have this new variable, it would be nice to make the players a bit more vulnerable during aiming, so they won't aim all the time, only at the right time. We can do that by multiplying the movement speed variable with the number between 0 and 1 when the isAiming boolean variable is true. Let's use a new character attribute variable for the penalty, so we can change it later in the inspector window. And don't forget to declare it at the top under the character attribute section. Let's set its value to 0.5 in the inspector and try it out. Nice! Let's continue to work on the animations. The next step we need to do is to create the aiming and shooting animation clips. Let's open up the animator and animation windows. The sprite sheet contains the standing poses for aiming and shooting first. Let's call them aim idle and shoot idle with the direction as the suffix. After these animations, their walking variations come in the sprite sheet. Let's quickly create the animations for those as aim walk and shoot walk. We use these new animations in the blend tree. Let's double click the movement state and start modifying the blend tree. We need to replace the simple walk down animation with a new blend tree that has all three walking animations, the current one, the aiming one, and the shooting one. Let's hit the plus icon and create a new blend tree. Let's copy its threshold. We need to click the blend tree itself, so we can rename it and create its motion fields. We have to add the three animations as three motion fields. Now, the thing is, because all of our animations are in blend trees, we can't easily transition from one animation to another in the old-fashioned way. Fortunately, I've come up with a workaround. We can create a new float animation parameter, let's call it aiming state, and use this parameter to switch between the three animations. If we want the original walking animation, we can set its value to 0, but if we want the new shooting animation, we can set it to 1. We need to change the blend tree's parameter to this new aiming state parameter. And that's it. But before we jump into the code, let's remove the old walk down motion field. Okay, we need to set this parameter's value based on the inputs. Let's create an if statement with the isAiming variable in its condition. If isAiming is true, then we need to set the aiming state parameter to 0.5, which switches the walking animation to the aiming one. But if it's false, then we have to set it to 0, which is the original walking animation. Let's try it out. It works perfectly. Now we need to make the shooting animation work too. This animation should be played for a short time after the archer has shot an arrow. To do this, we need to have some kind of timer that helps us keep track of the elapsed time while we play the shooting animation. Let's create a new float variable called shooting recoil and set its default value to 0. Let's scroll down to the process inputs function and start this timer when we release the fire button. We need to set its value to something greater than 0, but let's have a dedicated variable for that, so we can fine-tune it later in the inspector. We have to decrease the value of shooting recoil with the time elapsed between the current and the last frame, but we only need to do this when it's greater than 0. Okay, now we can use this variable to set the aiming state animation parameter's value to 1, so it plays the shooting animation. Let's see how it looks. The 1 second recoil will probably be a bit long. I guess 0.2 will be cool. Okay, we only need to do the rest of the directions in the blend tree, and we are done. Let's try it out. It's not bad, but the animation can transition from the aiming to the running without playing the shooting animation. I forgot to modify the movement, and now during the shooting animation, the archer doesn't get the aiming penalty. We need to add an additional condition to the if statement, which handles the aiming penalty. This modified if statement slows down the player, either if the is aiming is true, or our shooting recoil is counting down. This will fix it, and it is also a clever little game design, because it makes the shooting players even more vulnerable, so they won't spam arrows without thinking. Awesome! As you may have noticed, I reworked the player controls a bit, so only one stick is required to play the game. This one stick controls both moving and aiming. However, this makes it impossible to aim without moving, which I think isn't the best. So I'd like to make a lock mechanism to have the option to stay still, but also aim and shoot at the same time. We'll achieve this by having a button on the controller to prevent having any movement. Let's define a new variable called lockPosition, and in the process inputs function set its value to player.getButtonLockPosition. We need to open up Rewired's editor and create a new action called lockPosition. I click reassign it to the right trigger. Now we only need to zero out the movement speed based on the lockPosition. Let's try it out. Awesome! We can stay still and shoot. Let's create the aiming and shooting animations for it. We need to open up the animator and animation windows. Just like we did earlier, we'll replace the idle motion fields with the idle blend trees that have the aiming and shooting animations as well. These new blend trees will also use the aiming state animation parameter. Let's create them quickly and replace the motion fields. Nice, it looks pretty neat. Let's wrap up this episode by extending the process inputs function with mouse and keyboard inputs. First, let's declare a useController variable under the input settings group. We use this variable to switch between controller and keyboard mouse inputs. In the process inputs function, we need to create an if statement based on this new variable. The existing lines go to the true block. In the false block, after an else, we need to define a new vector2 variable called mouseMovement. This will represent the mouse's movement during the current frame. By default, Unity defines these mouseX and mouseY inputs for us. We have to add this vector to the movement direction, so it will change when we move the mouse. And we need to normalize it too. Let's set the movement speed variable to input that getX is vertical. This lets us use the W and up arrow keys to move forward. Is aiming and end of aiming are almost the same, but with input in front instead of player. These are also defined by default. But for lock position, we need to open up the input window and let's rename the fire free to lock position. This way, the left shift key will lock the archer's movement. Let's test it. It works. We only need to hide and lock the cursor, so we won't click some random button in the editor accidentally. We can do that by changing the cursor's lock state to logged and its visibility to false in the awake function. Now it should be perfect. Awesome! You can make the cursor visible again by hitting the escape key, so you can stop the game. That's it for today, folks. Next time we'll work on the arrows to make them actually hit the walls and other archers. Yes, that's right, we'll make the game playable in local multiplayer in the next episode. So be sure to subscribe and leave a thumbs up. If you have any questions about what you have just seen, feel free to ask and I try to answer all of them. See you next time!